Okay, I'm presenting this paper on behalf also of my colleagues, specifically Anna Eiberger, who graduated already and who could not make it here. And let me start with the observation that we are, since let's say over a decade now, we are living in the age of smartphones, smart watches, and Florian, as you pointed out rightfully, these are the body proximate displays that I'm referring to in the talk, right? So actually displays that are close to your body that are either handheld or worn on your wrist. It could also be a smart bracelet, a fitness tracker, or, and so on. And also since the early 2010s, starting actually 2011, we witnessed an increase in, let's say, optical see-through head-mounted displays for both enterprise usage and also to a certain extent for, let's say, consumer and consumer-oriented products. And prior work has actually investigated and looked into what happens if we join these body proximate displays and these optical see-through displays into one interaction space. So Serrano et al. Looked at that in a desktop setting. Normand et al. At last year's ISMA, they used the video see-through display to extend the virtual screen of a smartphone. And our work at CAI in 2015, it has been a while, also looked at the joint interactions that are possible between a smartwatch, a smartphone, and these optical see-through head-mounted displays. These ideas have even been picked up by commercial vendors like the NEC Corporation in 2016, where they explored, let's say, also prototypes which use a physical or virtual keyboard on your arm. And if you closely look at all these conceptual pictures or also at the picture below, you might have the impression it's a great idea. The field of view of an existing display is extended. It might just work or as, let's say, exemplified in this video. The idea is you have a small display close to you. You simply put on an AR glass and you're happy, right? Because you are actually just extending the field of view of that smart glass, right? That's the assumption that you could have. But as you also might know, this is not really the case. So here we have just one example that is that we have accommodation issues. So typically you can either focus on the smartwatch or smartphone, which is close to you, or at the virtual display plane of your optical see-through display, which could be an infinity, could be a 2 or 3 meters, depending on the display type. And it's actually a bit worse than what you see here in the video, and for that I want to make a short experiment with you. So maybe focus on, let's say, one lamp with your eyes and take your thumb in front of you, so those of you who are, you can make it, and do me a favor and repeatedly with both eyes focus back and forth. So background object, foreground object, background object, foreground object, back and forth. And what you should notice next to the blur that is created, that during refocusing you see these double images, right? So this is called physical diplopia, and this is basically due to the fact that our brain suppresses these double images behind and in front of the pons area, so specific area in our field of view, and only fuses the points in that area into a 3D image. But this illusion breaks, or this mechanism breaks, in the moment when we have to refocus. And depending on the task, this can happen quite frequently in such settings. So you actually have issues with focus and with diplopia when you use those displays. There has been a lot of prior work also in the domains of joint visual information processing and in optical visual issues, perception issues in optical see-through displays. Just for your reference, I'm pointing out to service from Lamboy et al. And also from my former colleague Ernst Kruif and Ed Swan. They made nice surveys on perceptual issues in optical see-through displays, and there are a lot of issues, but I want to point out two specific works, one from Joe Gebbert and Ed Swan, also presented at ISMA last year, where they investigated, let's say, the effects of joint visual information processing on a monitor that you can see on the top, and a monocular optical see-through display. So they basically looked at text reading task, and the text was presented at different distances, both on the physical monitor and on the HMD, and they basically indicated that there's a cost of context switching when you switch between the physical monitor and the virtual display, and also that these different focus distances, of course, have a negative impact. And importantly, they looked at different distances ranging from 70 centimeters to 6 meters. Actually, 9 years ago now, our group, together with Anke Huckauf, investigated the effects when actually this information on the optical see-through display is aligned with a monitor. So focus wasn't an issue, accommodation wasn't an issue, because we used a virtual retinal display, a laser beam display, so it was a focus-free display. But even then, only when switching between a head-mounted display and the information on the physical screen also induced already a cost in the order of 10% in reaction time. Now, let's say based on this prior work, we wanted to actually see what happens if we use those optical see-through head-mounted displays with a fixed focal plane in conjunction with smartwatches or smart phones, right? So our goal in this research was to quantify how well users are able to integrate this visual information that is jointly presented, and this is important, across, let's say, a display that, which is close to you, and an optical see-through head-mounted display, right? So, and we're referring to depth layers in this paper because we're not just using this distance for accommodation, but also the eyes verge in that distance. So that's why we are using this term here, depth layer, where you focus and verge at the same time, right? So we have a far depth layer, which is in your head-mounted display, and a near one, which is at your body proximate display, okay? So we designed, actually, a user study was within subjects designed. We had only one independent variable, which we called depth layers. And we had two conditions, one where we only used the head-mounted display to present the visual information, and I will show you the information that we used, the task that we used in a moment. And we then also had a second condition where we used display at a 30 centimeters distance, which is a typical reading distance both for smartphones and smartwatches. So this has been shown by prior work, right? And as you see, we were using a projector here instead of a smartphone or smartwatch for a very simple reason, because for the task at hand, we needed a bezel-free display not to interfere with the optical see-through head-mounted display. And we, in fact, also looked in, let's say, pre-tests that this wouldn't have an adverse effect compared to a smartphone or smartwatch to a panel display. So what we were looking at were typically performance measures: how fast are people, how much errors do they do, and what kind of effort this induces, both in terms of workload, as indicated by NASA TLX, and also in terms of simulator signals, as you might see when you focus back and forth all the time, there might be quite some issues. Okay, we had 24 participants. We actually had a gender balance design, 12 female, 12 male. And we had a very simple task, a very boring task, if you want so, to say so. The question was, is a zero present among distractors, which we are O's? And I will show them to you on the next slide, and we will go through the task in a moment. Right, so we had that controlled lab setup, where we had the far distance at 3.7 meters. Why 3.7 meters? Because this was the default vergence distance of the display. It was actually EPSMOVERO BT100, which has a collimated imager. That means the graphics are typically shown, indicated in infinity. But we actually made sure that at the 3.7 meters, the graphics were in the depth of field. So this was not an issue here. And then we had a small display, as you can see on the lower right, 4x5x7.5 centimeters at 30 centimeter distance. And we had the participants in this chin rest in order to have a stable visualization. And then they were asked to look if a zero was present among the O's. And I want to conduct this task with you for a moment just to give you an understanding. So my request to you is the following. I will show you a slide with 84 symbols. And as fast as possible, if you think that the zero is present, raise your right arm. And if you think it is not present, raise your left arm. Okay? So we do that twice. Are you ready? Okay, so let's go. Okay, that's slow, but it's fine. You will see. Yeah. So the answer is it's not present. And we will do it once more. Okay, you ready? And let's go. Okay, so immediately, actually, right? So this was, why was that an easy task? Because you just look for the difference in these images, right? So that was a super easy task. And we wanted to avoid this effect in the experiment. And that's why we actually introduced a distractor task, which had no, deeper meaning. Between those individual images, users actually had to look at a star and to tell us if the star was pointing upwards or downwards. And this was solely meant to delete the prior mental image that they had in mind, and this actually worked out. Okay? So the procedure was as following. We had an initial briefing. We also had a visual acuity test where we actually just looked if those people were eligible for inclusion in this in this procedure. Then they could train the counterbalance conditions, so either they started with two depth layers or one depth layer. They conducted the task very often, right? So they had in total 560 images they had to judge in four blocks and conditions. So we selected in total 107,520 samples, and it was really boring, I can tell you. So I conducted it myself, but later on, more about that. And it took about 60 minutes per participant. Okay? And I will show you the conditions one more in a short video that you get a better understanding of how it looked like. So here's one condition, and we filmed with a single camera through the HMD on the lower left, right? So you don't have a stereo effect here. But you get the idea, and the user actually had to press keys on a keyboard to conduct this task, right? Left key, right key, and the B and the space bar, and they were in this condition. And this was the two depth layers. You only see the accommodation changing. You don't see the double images here, right, where they had to focus back and forth between these two layers of information which were jointly presented and were conducting the tasks then. Okay? So we expected, based on prior work, of course, that this condition, the second condition with the two depth layers, it would be worse. This was also our hypothesis, but we didn't expect the scale of what we then witnessed. Okay? Let's start with the task completion time. Not talking about the absolute numbers, and the important message is on the bottom of the slide. Basically, when the task was conducted across this body proximate display, the projector, and the head-mounted displays, people took about 50% longer on average, right? So instead of around 2 seconds, they took around 3 seconds on average to answer the question, is the zero present or not? Yeah. We had a large effect size, and this cannot be explained by focusing alone. So the average human, a healthy adult, takes around 250 to, 400 milliseconds to refocus from one plane into infinity. So this cannot be explained by that fact alone. And for the error rate, so the number of false decisions, if a zero is present or not, we also had a surprise. We actually had an increase of over 100% in error rate when they were using those both displays at a time. Yeah, even though it's not super high, it still was over 100%. And also this, let's say, this dual task was, or this task was also reflected in the workload. We actually found in the NASA PLX significant differences for all dimensions, but performance and physical demand. So the two depth layer condition was worse in almost every regard, in each regard. But we didn't find any differences regarding simulator thickness indicators, right, for the whole sample. But we indicated there were differences indicated between male and female subjects, which is actually also predicted by prior work. If you're interested in the details, please have a look at the paper. What we also did after these performance measures and after the subjective feedback, we also had a semi-structured interview asking the participants about the search strategies. And if you look at a single layer at a time when the information was only presented on the head-mounted displays, the majority actually looked in a regular shape, here in this case a Z shape, searching the display like that. Some indicated to have looked in the middle first and then in a clockwise order to look at the different corners of the displays. So this was for the single depth layer, and if we are looking at the two depth layers, six participants have noticed that they were always focusing on the front display first, and I have to say that the star, where the secondary task was also always displayed there. It was always displayed in the front display, right? So they first looked at the near display, and then they looked in the back. Around four participants did it the other way around. And three participants, interestingly, I don't know if they were too lazy or too tired already, they solely focused on the HMD, right? So that means they always saw double images and blurred versions of the display in front, and they conducted their task like that. And the rest of the participants, they switched regularly between those displays. And also we ran analysis if there were any differences between those groups in terms of performance or also task load, but we could not indicate any difference. Okay, our research also has certain limitations. If you can think, you can vary a lot of parameters in these experiments. You could use other display types, panel displays, other head-mounted displays. You can vary the display parameters, resolution, field of view, and so on and so forth. We don't have a reason to believe that those parameters will substantially change the effect or the effect size of what we see here. What will likely have an effect is that if you converge these two distances together, but the question remains if it's actually linear effect here. And also, I told you that we used a single depth layer, so people had to verge and focus at a single distance. You could also see that you separate that again. You have a collimated display, but put the vergence plane nearer to the viewer, but of course then you also run into vergence accommodation conflicts again. So to summarize, we had this visual search task over two depth layers, mimicking a scenario where you have a head-mounted display and you want to augment information on a smartphone or smartwatch. This actually led to a substantial increase in task completion time, circa 50%, and a much, much higher error rate. In future work, we want to study this joint visual information processing, utilizing further depth layer distances, so we want to bring the display closer to the user again and just study if it's linear dependency or not. We will want to investigate further display types again, so the current HoloLens 2 is using laser beam scanning display, so should also be focus free and might support a better viewing experience, but we don't know. And also what we didn't do, we didn't utilize eye tracking for quantifying basically the effects of the search strategies, and this is definitely something that we should look in the future. So So with that, I'm done, and I thank you very much for your attention, and I'm open to questions. Thank you so much. Yes. So there was nothing. So we.
Even for those who ignore the center.
Yeah. So if you don't have any questions now, you can also contact me anytime later, and feel free to ask. It's also fine. Yes. Yes. So basically, these are, in my view, details. For example, in the simulator sickness, we indicated, differences for this total severity, both in HMD and HMD plus projector. That actually means, in our case, that female participants they experienced a higher severity or higher disorientation compared to male participants, but only within, let's say, one condition. If you compare the condition female HMD versus female HMD plus projector, there weren't any significant differences. I don't know if I recall your question correctly, but I mean what we did in the past was, and you see it here on the lower left. I mean we had the exact same task in the past. We actually replicated the appearance of that task, and we only had a single depth plane back then. Yeah, and there still were noticeable effects with. Order of 10%, not to the extent that we witnessed now, but also back then. And what needs to be done in future work to see what kind of, or what is actually causing these effects that, exactly. Yeah. So what are the factors behind that? Well, my hypothesis is that it's really the distance. I mean, it's a large distance between the near point and the far point. But I don't know if it actually would change linearly if we will get them closer together, yes or no. Yeah?
My question is, you're measuring cognitive load.
Yes.
You can measure it on screens. You can measure it on screens, right?
Yes.
You're measuring reactions to screens.
Yes, correct.
But did you have a test condition where it's not screens? Because we frequently have tasks when depth of view is changed.
Yes. No, we didn't, because otherwise...
Just to compare, if the luminosity of the screen, transparency, crispness, is adding or reducing that?
Yeah, of course, and it's known from literature that these display parameters, they certainly add to the effect, to the scale, but not to that extent. I mean, we actually had a prior experiment where we also used a smartphone, where we had these bezel effects, and of course there might be effects of screen resolution, of screen brightness, and so on and so forth. But the main argument here is that they are not the primary source of the effects that you witness here. They can have a contribution. We could also use a cardboard and just exchange those things, but it's not that they will contribute substantially to the effects that you are seeing. So I can pretty much assure you that there will be effects, but they won't be substantial. Yeah, maybe it won't be 49%. Maybe it will be 48 or 51%. But it will still be a substantial effect.
I understand, but here is my question.
Okay. And
question. Oh.
No. We can. I'm happy to talk with you, but maybe we do it on a personal basis after that talk.
Yeah.